There were about 8 American reporters covering the 8th Air Force. And every time, can you imagine this happening today? The public relations, 8th Air Force public relations actually called each one of us if there was going to be a raid the next day. And they would have some cryptic remark like, there's going to be a mail delivery tomorrow. You know, not very hidden. But I mean, you know, we were fighting the same war. It's not like now. We were on the American side. And so we would all convene at the railroad station the next morning, 6 or 7 or 8 of us. We get in the cars and go out. We used to go to, there were just a couple of big towns we'd go to, and then we'd be met by various public relations people from the various bomber groups. We'd each go to a different one usually, but I made some great friends. Walter Cronkite was one of the people in that group, and he's been a friend ever since. I went on 5 raids, 2 with the B-17s and 3 with the B-26s, which was a good deal less dangerous because they were not, their targets were not into Germany.
Have some memories about those B-17
trips? Well, I do. I have not only my memory of my own trips on the B-17, but I can break into tears thinking about the bomber crews that were lost. I would get to know them. And you know, you would go in the barracks and they were losing so many. A bomber group had maybe 18 or 20 planes in the crew, 10 men on a bomber. And they were in barracks, bed on bed. And they would make great friends with the other guys in other crews. And you know, they'd come back at night. They were losing 5%, and they had to do 25 missions. Well, it didn't take any mathematical genius to know what your chance were of finishing 25 missions if they were losing 5% on every raid. I mean, you got a break because some of the replacements were shot down. But so not many guys made it the whole 25 missions in those early days. And I remember I was talking to a crew member, a gunner, sitting on his bunk one night, and he had over his head, he had marks, the number of missions, and he'd paint 4 and then he'd draw a line through it. And there were 17 marks on the wall. So I said to him, gosh, you've done 17 missions? He said, no, that was the guy before me. In other words, the man who had marked that overhead had been shot down just a few days earlier. That was desperately sad. It was interesting. I later spent a lot of time with the infantry after the invasion. And it was always interesting for me to ponder, wonder about the relative sadness of life in the Air Force and life in the infantry. I mean, the infantry, the dog faces, never got out of there. They were in the rain and the slop, and day after day they were there and they could get killed. Air Force, they lived quite a civilized life. I mean, it was terrible when they were in that thing and over Germany with the fighter planes and the anti-aircraft guns blazing away and great possibility of their getting killed. I mean, the possibility of getting killed was greater in the Air Force than it was in the infantry by the numbers. I mean, huge numbers, percentage-wise, of 8th Air Force men were shot down. I don't know the numbers. And also officers, because there was such a high preponderance of officers. There were 4 officers out of 10 men on a crew. So a great many officers were killed in the Air Force who were not killed in the infantry, and anywhere near the same numbers. But the Air Force, they'd come back, they got back, they were relieved, they were joyous, they had good food. They could go into London, usually find a girl to spend some time with. So they lived a relatively civilized life. And in a way, it made it more difficult for them because they never got inured to this battle condition. They broke away and lived a normal life for a day or two, and then they had to go do it again. Whereas the GIs were out there day after day slogging away, and there was no relief for them, but neither was there this emotional high and low.